Hey guys, CDTV the G here, and the G stands for, no one gives a fuck what the G stands for right now. Eminem just dropped a new album out of nowhere, The G Can Wait. Now you may notice I'm wearing a cap in this video, which is different to when I usually wear a beanie. Real quick, the reason for that is I'm just trying to differentiate myself from my twin, CDTV Productions. So you know, people see the guy with the cap, they're like, oh, that's CDTV the G. They see the guy with the beanie, they're like, oh, that's CDTV Productions. Now as for this album, I woke up like 30 minutes ago, I saw the rapper Hobson, because I have his tweet notifications on. I saw him say, Eminem shouted me out in Kamikaze, that's so crazy. I was like, what is Kamikaze? As far as I knew, nothing had dropped. And then I realized it was Friday, and new music typically drops on Friday, so I was like, oh, is Kamikaze a new Eminem single? So I went onto Apple Music, searched for Eminem, and then a bunch of tracks came up with the same artwork, and I was like, oh my god. Eminem has just dropped a surprise album out of nowhere. I don't know how the biggest rapper in the world, the most well-known rapper in the world, manages to hide the fact that he's bringing out an entire album, but I'm just so surprised and happy that he did. I imagine it's gonna be a lot of anger. I imagine he's gonna reference the really mixed to negative reception towards Revival, but let's get into it. Track number one. I'm assuming Eminem is definitely gonna address some criticisms. We have track number one, The Ringer. Holy fuck, whoa, whoa, whoa. I'm on Genius, just, you know, so I've got the lyrics up in front of me. Ronnie J is a co-producer on this track? I never thought we'd see an Eminem track co-produced by Ronnie J. That is interesting.
Because I feel like I want to punch the world in the fucking face right now.
So he is pissed.
Even have an opinion of you. You mention me. Millions of views. Attention and news. I mention you. Lose, lose for me. Win, win for you.
This is way different to Revival so far. We got a hard-ass beat. And, you know, here he seems to be criticizing the people that were criticizing Revival. Seeing him come back at critics is like something that Eminem does best, and he makes his best music when he's angry at people criticizing him for something. I'm just excited to see where this goes. This is Eminem in his element right now, at least in the main state that he's in, so hopefully that keeps coming through in the music, but I'm really liking this so far.
Little yachty, but not me though. Not even dissing, it just ain't for me. All I am simply is just an MC. Maybe Stan just isn't your cup of tea. Maybe a cup full of syrup and lean. Maybe I need it. These are things that I'd rather do than hear you on a mic since I tend to your mind is about ice. And Jesus Christ, man, how many times is someone gonna fuck a mic, bitch? Fuck my side chick! You won't ever see.
Yeah.
Turn down for what? I ain't loud enough.
I turned down for what reference? In 2018.
Man, how the fuck Sourpuss gonna get mad just cause his album sucks and now he wants to take it out on us?
I'm not sure how I feel about that, because there it does feel like Eminem's deflecting the criticisms a little bit. Because Revival, in my opinion, like, I thought it was okay, but I thought it was a disappointing album. It seems like Eminem is blaming the critics for not liking it here, rather than saying, oh, maybe I just didn't make that great of an album. And maybe he still feels like it was a really good album, that's fine. But it seems like he's more kind of brushing off the criticisms here as people who wanted to dislike the album or didn't really get it. At least that's what I'm getting from this so far.
I heard you mumbling, but it's jumbled and mumble trouble. The era that I'm from upon you, that's what it's coming to. What the fuck you gonna do when you run into it? I'm gonna come with you.
Oh my
god. You if you ain't joining, if you ain't Kendrick,
hey, shout out to Joyner. Who's on this album? No, Eminem, that's wrong. We don't want you to use autotune, okay? That's not the criticisms people made of Revival. Am I missing the point of what he's trying to say here? Because I don't want to believe that Eminem could be this kind of blind in a way as to why people didn't like Revival. I don't think anyone criticized Revival for not making use of autotune.
If I don't pull myself from the jaws of defeat and rise to my feet, I don't see why y'all even started with me.
It's a hard track though. I like the BET cipher. People did say that.
Every one of y'all, if you call the fire engine green, aquamarine, or you think water is pink, that line in the sand, was it even worth it? Because the way I see people turn is making it seem worthless. It's starting to defeat the purpose. I'm watching my fan base shrink to thirds, and I was just trying to do the right thing. But if I could go back, I'd at least reword it and say I empathize with the people.
Okay.
Evil serpent, so the dream to the knees deserted.
That's interesting. I like that.
Listen, he's too scared to answer me with words.
Look, Trump's not going to respond, okay? Of course he'd lyrically get murdered, he's not a rapper. I like what he did towards the end of the track lyrically here, where he talked about the BET cipher, and that he kind of regrets the fact that he told anyone that supports Donald Trump to go fuck themselves. You know, he says here, but if I could go back, I'd at least reword it. So I think that was really cool. He admitted that it was maybe flawed the way he delivered that. Either way, I really loved the BET cipher. One thing I hope I don't see too much of in this album is Eminem calling out a bunch of other mainstream rappers, though, because it just seems kind of unnecessary at this point. You know, because he did drop a few names in here. I especially don't agree with his perception on the criticisms of Revival, but really like how this one sounds. I could see myself listening to it a lot. Love the beat, the production on here. He sounds focused, at least. I can definitely say that he sounds focused. It was a good start. We're one track in, and I've nearly recorded for like 20 minutes. There was a lot to talk about there. Let's go to track number two, Greatest. And Make Will Made It has a production credit on here. Oh my god, that beat is energetic. Average hook, not really feeling that. Oh yeah, let me get this out the way. I know there's people that are pissed about the way I mispronounce the name. Oh, that's good. I don't even know how to say their name, to be fair. I think it's D Antword. I remember on Revival, Eminem called them Die Antword, and apparently they got really pissed about that. So I like how he addressed that on here. That's pretty funny. That's fair. I'm listening to a new Eminem album. It's really sinking in. The same thing happened when I listened to Astroworld, except this is like multiplied by 10. Yeah, I really like that song. That one definitely ramped the energy up after the more kind of, I guess, a slower tempo sound of the first track, where Eminem was still aggressive, but it was a slower tempo beat. This one was just bouncing all over the place, and Eminem did match that with his flow. He was... One thing that's really interested me so far is the production credits, because like I said, Ronnie J produced co-produced the first one, and Mike Will Made It co-produced this one, you know, two very mainstream trap producers. So I'm really interested to see if that continues throughout the album. Like I said, the hook was a little annoying, but it is like stuck in my head now, so that hook might really be something that grows on me, and I could see it being good for like a concert or something. So track number three. Oh, wondering if this was ever going to come when Eminem, I believe he said in a magazine interview that Joyner was one of his favorite artists. We have Lucky You, Eminem featuring Joyner Lucas. Joyner Lucas is literally one of my favorite rappers out right now. Possibly my favorite rapper out right now. I love everything that he drops. I don't even know how to describe it. He's just fantastic. He's just incredible. I'm riding his dick. So let's go into this. Track number three, Lucky You featuring my dad, Joyner Lucas. Lucky you, fuck you too. Y'all gotta move. Y'all gotta move. Y'all gotta move. Give me some room. Got the better to level up in the ghetto. The ghetto looking for something to put. Never fly now. Sugar relevant till the beat die down. The truth is nigga, they really want me tied down. Snakes in the grass trying to slither fast. I just bought a fucking lawnmower. I admit it, this is payback. Switch. I regret it. God damn. Asking me what the fuck happened to hip hop. I said I don't have any answers. Cause I took a nail when I dropped my last album. It hurt me like hell, but I'm back on these rappers. And actually coming from anyone has any fucking ability to even stick to a subject is killing me. The inability to pin humility. Hard to the bother, the weather. We make a bunch of fucking songs about nothing and mumble and fucking. Just stop talking about mumble rap, Eminem. Okay. All right. I love Eminem. I'm loving this song so far. I'm loving this album so far. But please stop talking about mumble rap. We get it. You don't like it. But a lot of people do. That's why it's so popular. People are still going to buy your music. There's a lot of people that still listen to what I guess people would call real music. Just let the mumble rap be. Let the mumble rappers have their fun. And this isn't me defending mumble rap. I'm not saying mumble rap is amazing. I'm just saying we don't need to hear about it for the whole album. On the freaking minute, got me thinking of finishing everything with a seed of minutes and reaping the benefits. I'm sleeping to Willigan as I'm thinking of thinking about evil intent of another beat I'm killing it. Cause even if I got it in a beating a pill again, even ketamine and methamphetamine with a mini then it better be at least 70 and 300 milligram and I might as well cause I'm gonna be in a feeling again. This album is something else so far in terms of its like production and energy. I'm really fucking with how this whole thing sounds so far. Joyner did a fantastic job here, as always. I really loved that switch from Joyner into Eminem. It was really smooth. And then Eminem's lyrics, again, like I said, we don't need to hear that you dislike mumble rap so much. We get it. It's like that's what hip-hop, mainstream hip-hop is nowadays. Hip-hop is always changing. And that's just what it is nowadays, and we just have to accept it. There's still a bunch of other rappers who rap over old school beats, who flow like crazy, who make aggressive songs, stuff like that, you know? There's everything is like available to you now in hip-hop. Apart from the mumble rap stuff, absolutely love this song. Even though I've had like something to criticize, mainly in the lyrics for every track, that doesn't mean I don't love them. I think this is amazing so far. I'm really enjoying it. So I'm just gonna run on to the next track because that's a skit into the next one. So the next one is Paul, which is a throwback to some of Eminem's older albums, so that's really good. And then that runs into track number five, which is Normal.
Just reply to everybody who you don't like what they have to say about you, or just stuff you're working on.
I mean, that's what it looks like so far. I like that skit. It was funny.
Why you always need a lecture? My ex hates to talk, she's a texter. Even when I'm in bed, lay right
this is some like Drake style singing. Get back together, until she gets just not together. As good.
She don't even know that she's the first thing I think of when I wake up and the last thing I think of before I go to sleep. Psych. Hope she don't know to a motherfucking crime scene. Maybe I'm just too ugly to compete with him. You weren't supposed to agree, you fucking bitch. I love you, but I hope you fucking die, though. In our business.
The singing delivery worked way better with this beat. Wasn't really sure how I felt about it until that beat switch. I'm liking this after the beat switch, I think.
Thinking I'm sly as I scroll through your iPhone. Who the fuck's
my iPhone? Alright, it's sounding a bit weird now.
What do I know? Let's sleep on it like they did Revival.
We're not sleeping on Revival, Eminem. It's quite a funny track. I'll give it that. I started to like that one more towards the end, I think. I think it's probably my least favorite track so far. Again, we were so close to the track just finishing without a reference to it. And then he talked about how everyone was sleeping on Revival. We weren't. We didn't sleep on it. I preferred the first beat, but I think the what Eminem was rapping like worked better with the second beat after the beat switched up. It got a bit weird when he's like, scrolling through your iPhone. The delivery was a little bit weird and it lasted for very long as well. I thought he was only going to do that delivery for a short portion of the track, but that was like a whole verse. But overall, it was a fun track. It was entertaining. So let's go on to track number 6, M Calls Paul, which is a skit, which then runs into Stepping Stone.
But I swear to God, this motherfucker lives in Michigan and I think I figured out his address. And I'm on my way to his fucking house right now.
Alright, who's he addressing on that? I'm pretty sure Sean C criticized that line, and I'm pretty sure Sean C lives in Michigan. And Sean C tweeted about this as well. Eminem really cares about how people react to his album online, doesn't he though? So let's go to track number 7, which is Stepping Stone.
It's 2002, everything was totally new. We were globally huge, watching sales go through the roof. We wrote when we feuded, Onion Adam soldiers included, a multitude of homies who were down for no good excuse.
I'm getting like a Lake Toy Soldiers vibe from this.
I just noticed the oomph was gone when we go in the booth, cause the truth is the moment the proof died, so did the group.
Yeah.
I forgot to make amends.
I like this type of singing hook from Eminem. The way he's harmonizing here sounds good. It's not like it sounds, it's amazing singing, but it's like catchy.
Which reminded me, busy, Rockstar was the shit. Y'all could have got you a hit without me on the shit. Is this the kind of karma you get for turning your fucking back on busy, Canaver and Swift? A Freudian slip, subconsciously, I honestly wish. I ain't feel so much guilt, and y'all didn't harbor resentment. But it's hard to pretend that y'all ain't got none of this. I love all of you, man, but I just can't be the guy.
Damn.
Always be here, but that spark isn't there. Bless us, let for closure, so let's let this go. It's not goodbye to our friendship, but D12 is over.
Okay, so we're switching up the subject matter again, and we got like an emotional track now. Yeah, this was all about D12. D12 and how they grew more distant, and how, you know, Eminem was the only one from that group that really blew up to a big level. No one else really did. And Eminem kind of analyzes like why that's the case, and how they can't really expect him to, you know, carry all those guys on his back. Eminem's confirmed here that D12 is over. He doesn't want any part of it, you know? There's not that real bond as a rap group there anymore. We've never seen Eminem really talk about D12 kind of disintegrating in his music before, so it's definitely a bit of a new subject for him to tackle as well. And I'm also really interested to see how the members of D12 respond to this, if they respond at all. It was interesting. I liked it. It was a good analysis of what happened and seeing how Eminem feels about the whole D12 thing. So, now we got track number 8, Not Alike. Oh, and featuring Royce da 5'9". So technically we got a bit of a Bad Meets Evil thing going on here, which is always fantastic. Can we get Hell the Sequel, the sequel, please? We need a part 2 to that. Tay Keith? We have Tay Keith producing on an Eminem album? Well, the beat already sounds like Look Alive, because, you know, Tay Keith, he just makes the same beat over and over and over and over again. But I'm incredibly intrigued now. Is this going to be a track making fun of mainstream rappers again? Because it really feels like that's what it's going to be with this type of beat.
Rain Dead, Eye Drops, Paint Meds, Cyclops,
Bad and Bougie Flow,
iPod, Mate.
Yep.
That's how much we have in common, yeah? That's how much we have in common.
Oh no. I liked it at first, and I liked it a lot more when I was younger. But right now, it's kind of played out, the whole thing where it's like, oh, I'm going to use stereotypical rapper flows. I'm going to make a typical rap song, but do it better than mainstream rappers would do. You know, it's like imitating them. It's like taking the piss out of them whilst you're rapping the same way they do. It was cool at first, but it seems a bit played out now. I don't got high goons, I'd rather try to buy the moon and breathe freely. The sky is blue, the tire is new, the Maserati white and cool like GE's. Why these dudes trying to white and cool like GE's. Y'all music sound like Dr. Seuss inspired to hire a stripper, prostitute, retiring. Royce the 5'9 killed that. That's how much we have in common. I really like that verse. And I'm talking to you, but you already know who the fuck you are. There's that Ronnie J bass. Godzilla horse with a hard shell, but a motherfucking heart bigger than Bizarre's belly. Only time you'll ever say I lost, you'll be talking about Fetty Wap, better call Diddy. I lost Fetty Wap. Invisible with the pinnacle, the pinnacle, the sick individual. Oh, God. Minimal and fucking these syllables. I let him knock on my genitals. I'm a fucking invincible, indefensible, despicable, typical, predictable, unpredictable. I spit the formidable. Did you bitch you fucking with the original? I consider me a nickel identical. The tongue shrug shoulder, 1 month old, the sponge mug fold, and unrug, holster lock, nut, coaster, long jug, roast a young thug, poster, unplug, toaster. I'm not sure how any of that stuff related, but the rhymes were cool.
That track was interesting. Never thought I'd hear an Eminem song that was produced by Ronnie J and Tay Keith.
Royce da 5'9 did a fantastic job on his verse. And then Eminem, I quite liked what Eminem did in here. Not as much. I think Royce did better on this track personally. But yeah, there was cool bits of wordplay throughout here. Interesting that he said something about a heart being bigger than Bizarre's belly after that D12 track. And then of course we had a nice little fast rapping part, you know? I really do like how the Ronnie J's part of the track, which was obviously the 808s, kicked in when Eminem started rapping. It kicked in during his verse. It really added a hard sound to this track. Like, right now I'm not really sure if Eminem is doing this whole thing like ironically or to prove a point, or if he genuinely just wants to work with these new age hip-hop producers like Ronnie J and Tay Keith, because these people produce for the rappers that Eminem is criticizing. I don't know if Eminem's doing it ironically or to prove a point, but the fact is that he sounds pretty damn good over this. Overall, I think it's a very hard track, though. I like this one. So, on Rap Genius, it says the next track should be Kamikaze, but for me on Apple Music, the next track is Fall. I don't know if there's just something wrong with my Apple Music, because I just checked Spotify, and on Spotify, Kamikaze is before Fall. So I'm gonna listen to Kamikaze first. So, track number 9, or on Apple Music, track number 10 for some reason, Kamikaze. Don't... I'm a fucking kamikaze crashing into everything. I'm about to smash into everyone, crash into everything. Back and I've just begun. Back 2017. We don't need another fact. No. No. I turned to rap because it made me feel tough when I wasn't. From the moment I heard rap is. Is this necessary? Do we need this? Smash into everyone, crash into everything. Back and I've just begun. Back 2017. Back on everyone. Back on everyone. We don't need a third verse. Let's just end it there, Eminem. We don't need a third verse. We don't. I'm no conspiracy theorist, but something here is afoot. Oh yeah, it's my dick. Get the measuring stick. What? 12 inches of wood. I've come to pay respects, cause if you sleep, you're fucked. This part of the beat is hard, okay. That was just a whole lot of confusion, just from the track list being weird, not knowing which track was Kamikaze, what one was Fall. That was the title track of the album. Like, sure, okay, I get it. He's probably trolling with this, but I don't like it. This track didn't need to be here. That's awful. I don't even know what to say about this. I just need a second to recharge after that. Oh my god. Let's go on to track number 10, which is Fall. We're getting close to the end of the album now. There's how many more tracks left? Like, four left, and this is one of those four. So track number 10, Fall. I'm sick and tired of waiting. I done lost my patience. I can take all of you motherfuckers on it. Once you want it shady, you got it. You know what I've noticed? Eminem's voice on this track, it sounds more like it did during Recovery, because Eminem's voice always seems to change with every album. Here it sounds kind of like his Recovery voice, which is good in my opinion. Oh, an academic shout. Damn. Hold up. Huh. I mean, I know Tyler, he really didn't have nice things to say about Walk on Water, I think it was, but come on, Eminem. You're a man. You can take another rapper criticizing you. Nah. Boy, Eminem did not just call Earl Sweatshirt Earl the Hooded Sweater. Earl Sweatshirt was inspired by you, Eminem. Why are you dissing everybody? You're dissing the mumble rap
You're dissing people that actually make genuine emotional rap about their mental state. You're dissing people that make experimental creative rap. Do you like anyone in the rap game, Eminem? It's like a backhanded compliment because he's saying Earl could help Tyler improve his rhymes because Earl is fantastic at rhyming. But he also just showed that he doesn't give a fuck about Earl by getting his name wrong. And I got no faith in your writers, I don't believe in ghosts. Mm, that's nice. I like that line. Oh, there's the Hobson shout out that he was talking about. You know who else you inspired, Eminem? Earl Sweatshirt and Tyler the Creator. First of all, really like the chorus on this one. Those vocals are incredibly smooth. Like I said, I like Eminem's voice and his flow on here. The way he's delivering this stuff, it's more steady paced. And again, it just, like I said on some earlier tracks, it just sounds more focused, which is always a good thing. Really don't think those Tyler the Creator and Earl Sweatshirt shots were necessary. I don't know what's gonna happen with that, but I'm not happy about that, man. I'm not happy about that. But yeah, it was a pretty good track. Again, there's just a lot I don't agree with lyrically on this album. Even though Eminem is delivering his lines in a smart way, they're pretty funny and well put together. Just some of the stuff he's saying, just not really feeling it. Overall, the track was pretty good. I like that one. But yeah, let's go to track number 11, which is Nice Guy featuring Jesse Reyes. You'll go back home, right? Right? Suck my dick. You fucking suck, man. Suck my dick. You know what's interesting? This sounds like an Odd Future type track. I hop in your whip and take a sip, then I gun it. I don't got my self-control, I hope that you running. I'm bipolar with the switch up just as quick like you coming. I'm not a cheater, but if I'm gonna be accused, might as well. You tell me you'll take me back. This is giving me some Revival vibes. I get the concept of the track, but it just sounds a bit ass. That was another one of the worst tracks on the album. Jesse Reyes was good at some parts, but after she does the psych part, everything just kind of goes downhill. Her parts on the verses were kind of annoying. Again, it's just about a dysfunctional relationship, as Eminem's already talked about on this album with Normal, and as he's already talked about on multiple other albums. Just not a huge fan of this one. Very short song, but didn't really need to be here. Not very notable at all. So let's go on to track number 12. Which is Good Guy, again featuring Jesse Reyes. To be a housewife who outright lies, she's blackout drunk. Now she's about the same topic, but I really like the beat on here. Am I the good guy or do I just play like him and hope that he dumps you? It's like a dream come true. Just to scream fuck you. Guess you take life in the same way you play dice then. Cause you just look at me and roll them little snake eyes and damn. Jesse Reyes sounds good here. Don't know what she was doing on Nice Guy during the verses. Okay, so I mean that's pretty much the end of the Kamikaze album, I feel like, because the next track number 13, is Venom, which is it's from the movie soundtrack for Venom. So I think that's a really weird way to close an album. I guess you could kind of count it as a bonus track in a way. But anyway, Good Guy. It was an okay song. Again, just about broken relationships, and I think this song would have hit me harder if it wasn't a topic we'd already heard about throughout Eminem's, 20-year-long career. This just didn't really hit me that much, you know? Honestly, if I could cut, you know, some songs off of this album, I'd just cut off Kamikaze, Nice Guy, and Good Guy. Fall would have honestly made for a great, or a pretty good outro track. But either way, we're at the end of this album now, the end of the new Eminem album, and definitely already I'm feeling like there's going to take a lot more listens before I fully decide how I feel about it, you know? Because this first one, there's so much to absorb with how different it is to Revival and the fact it just came out of nowhere. But either way, track number 13, the final one. Very weird way to end it, but we have the song Venom. It's got a very similar sound to tracks like Phenomenal, you know, like Eminem's other soundtrack songs. I think that's another hook that's gonna need to grow on me, but I think it will grow on me. And that is us finished with Eminem's Kamikaze. Yeah, that one, I still feel the same way I felt about it before listening to it, which is that it's just a very strange way to close out your album, essentially promoting a movie, like at the end of your album. It was a decent song. Again, just like I said with Good Guy and Nice Guy, this one, again, I feel like it's something we've heard before, purely because Eminem's done like the Southpaw soundtrack, which had songs like Phenomenal, which was very similar in message and tone to this one. Very similar structure as well. Honestly, you know what? This could have been a very nice, consistent 9-track album, in my opinion. You just take off Kamikaze, Nice Guy, Good Guy, and just leave Venom to be on the Venom soundtrack. You know, it doesn't need to be on this project, Kamikaze. That's how I feel about that one. So overall, how do I feel about Kamikaze, the new Eminem album? Definitely better than Revival, I will say that. Not as consistent as I would have hoped for an album that's 13 tracks long, you know, a lot shorter than Revival was, a lot shorter than quite a few Eminem albums. But it's not a bad album at all. Definitely better than Revival. Really loved how this opened up. I think the first 3 tracks are fantastic. Again, even though throughout a lot of the album, I was disagreeing with stuff that Eminem said and his perception of the criticisms of Revival. The Paul skit was funny. Normal was a pretty good song. It was okay. Stepping Stone was good to hear some emotional stuff about D12. And Eminem's perspective on all of that, and Not Alike actually went pretty damn hard. Kamikaze, we can just forget about that. Fall was pretty good. I think Fall would have made for a nice outro track, because Nice Guy and Good Guy just weren't really necessary. So yeah, I mean, this is one that I'm really gonna need to listen to more and more, because it's really overwhelming at first. It's a lot to take in on a first listen. You know, the purpose of a first reaction isn't to give my perfect, like, formulated thoughts on the album, and that's how I'm feeling on the first reaction. I know that it's gonna take me a few more listens to really decide how good I think this album is, and to kind of give it like a number rating, you know? My twin, CDTV Productions, will also be listening to it. He'll make some type of video on this album, either a best songs or just an is it good review. It is interesting how a lot of it though is just about Revival and the criticisms of it. It's like the album, it's an album about an album for a lot of it, which is interesting. I'm not sure if I like that or not yet. Thank you so much for watching, guys. Let me know what you think of this album down in the comments below. Did it live up to your expectations? What were your best and worst tracks from the album? I mean, I read all my comments, so I'd be interested to hear what you have to say. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I will see you all in the next one. And yeah, that's all I gotta say. Thank you so much for watching, and this is CDTV the G, signing out.